Hello everyone, I welcome you again to the Net Zero Energy Building Knowledge Series for this week. As you know, this is a forum that brings industry experts to share their knowledge, expertise, ideas about high performance building design, different projects, policies, technologies, everything to do with energy efficiency. So we start the conversations on net zero energy. This program is an initiative under METRI, which is funded by USAID. METRI stands for Market Integration and Transformation for Energy Efficiency. You can know more about the program on the website metri.edsglobal.com. So today we're going to talk about daylight technologies. Last week also we spoke about buildings and some technologies which were incorporated in the Net Zero Energy Building at Sekh University. This week is just about a interesting technology for enhancing and enabling the harvesting of daylight. So it's not so buildings focused, but it's technology focused. So we thought you could do a deep dive into the technology and understand that a lot better. A bit about myself, I'm Deepa. I'm an architect and a green building consultant, and I will be the session moderator today. And with me, I have our expert speaker, Mr. Sekhar Nori. He is a strong proponent of daylight systems designed for high performance. As a CEO of Skyshades Inc, he has perfected cutting edge daylighting and shading solutions adapted for the Indian climate and customized for different applications. A recipient of 5 national awards for product innovation, his firm has provided lighting solutions for Fortune 500 companies like Pepsi, Unilever, and Toyota. In this webinar, he will discuss different technologies and controls for harvesting daylight. He is joining us today from Hyderabad. So I welcome you, Mr. Nori, to this webinar. And, you know, just a little brief about the topic today. It's pretty self-explanatory, daylight technologies, what it is about, but just a little context as to why are we talking about it in the NZ webinar series. Good daylighting is a key attribute in a high-performance building design. Sometimes there could be constraints to harvesting daylight, such as, you know, not having much access to sky or sunlight, or not having very deep floor plate, or maybe a limitation such as unshaded fenestrations that results in glare. In such cases, systems or strategies like light pipes, prismatic panels, light shells, and so on, help harvest more daylight and also enhance the quality of daylight in the space. This is a key attribute of any high performance building and a net zero as well. And of course, this not only results in energy savings, but also enhances the overall visual comfort in the space. So, Mr. Nori, I request you to please walk us through what some of these technologies are and also explain to us how this works.
Thank you, Deepa. Welcome, everyone. briefly, next 40 minutes or so, I'll just take you through the type of work probably on daylighting, what we have been doing, and all the technologies that we have been exploring for the last 10 years or so. Essentially, daylighting hitherto has been a concept wherein the building fenestration is handled through a glass, and daylight dissipation, daylight penetration, all this was happening through glass. Now that the buildings have been changing in terms of the floor plate, their composition, structure, then the need for a technology to bring in the daylight to get a deeper penetration and better utilization has been felt. So nearly 10 years back, we started our journey on this. And today, very briefly, I'll share all my experiences on this. Yeah, when we say about daylight, essentially we define the word daylighting, and we try to differentiate it from the word sunlight, in the sense that if it can be used, the sunlight, when it is used for a building illumination, normally we term it as a daylighting. So in the sense that it can be used for any building illumination only when there is no glare or and the heat content of it is controlled, then the inside ambience would be better. So such type of daylight is always welcome in the building. That is essentially what we call the daylighting. So in an essential part of the daylighting design is we need to somehow get a very indirect and diffused light into the building. We should not have glare in the workspace. So one should not feel inconvenient looking at any daylighting source. And we should always see the building electric lighting going in synchronous with the daylighting part. When you can design any building with a proper use of sunlight, then we call it a good daylighting design. Of course, there are a lot of building codes today, right from the IGBC, the Green Building Design Codes, the Griha, and even our Energy Conservation Building Code. They talk about the use of daylight in the buildings. So some of these codes talk about the percentage of the floor plate that needs to be properly daylit. Of course, daylighting today in India, because of energy shortage and more focused on energy efficiency, we give a lot of weightage to the energy efficiency part of it. Today, when we talk about the net zero buildings, the idea is that we should not use any of the energy, the conventional energy sources. So daylighting during the daytime, say 9 to 10 hours, if you are able to illuminate the building from the fenestration of the building properly and to the convenience of the building occupants, we call it as a fantastic and very good daylighting design. Daylight is very good to the human eye, because human beings as we are, we developed over a period of long years, we evolved, wherein our human eye is very much in sync with the daylight spectrum. Broadly, we will touch upon the strategies of doing daylight into the buildings. Essentially, we call them as a top lighting and side lighting. In top lighting, we mean that from the roof, how we get the light inside, the daylight. Side lighting means how we get the light from the windows, the curtain wall glazings, the structural, the huge glass facade glazings. From these, if you are able to get the light inside, we call them as a side lighting. Because the building overall fenestration is more of a roof and the side walls. How we manage this light, the sunlight, and for the illumination is generally what we are going to discuss upon. So in case of a top lighting, we use normally the skylights and of course the light pipes. In skylights, we have a range of skylights, right from a custom built skylight structures to the manufactured skylight systems. The manufactured skylight systems, the advantage is we get a multi-glaze system, sir, wherein you have a multiple layers of these glazings, and like a triple glazed and a double glazed systems, whereas the heat control is better, light can be controlled in a much better way without any glare. So light pipe is a technology wherein the sunlight is captured by a light collector, which is always exposed to sun. And that light collector collects the light and puts it into a pipe, and the light is transported through the pipe through a diffuser. It goes into the space. Today, the technology allows to do around 15 meter length of pipes, approximately around 60 feet length of pipes. You can transport the light very effectively without much of a light transmission loss. In a side lighting, essentially we are using the side, the glass, the windows, the curtain wall glazing, wherein we are getting the light inside. So in the top lighting, what we call the light pipe. So we have the light collector, which is always exposed to the sun. And there are different types of light pipes, which can deliver a different amount of lighting. So the diameters of the pipe, and they decide the quantum of light that can be delivered. So today light pipes can deliver nearly around 25,000 lumens of light into the building through the pipe of say a 300 mm diameter. So these type of systems can effectively transport light into building spaces, right into the basements of the buildings or any deep corners of the buildings. Now this photograph, what we saw is a retrofit in a railway station, the Secunderabad railway station. So this is a quite an old building wherein these are all retrofitted with the daylighting systems, and where light is being transported from a different place right into the space and giving the light inside. So these light pipes, you can use them right from the roof and from the walls also. So you wanted to fix a light pipe, you can have a wall collector, wall mounted collector as well, and take the pipe into the space wherever you wanted light. Now this picture shows a top lighting strategy of the rail coach factory building. This is based at Raibareli. This building is around a 15 meter height, and the importance of this building is that the entire roof is an insulated roof. So what we call the metal sandwich puff insulated panels, where the entire roof is insulated. Now in such a building, if you open up the roof with skylights, the bigger skylights, then you get a lot of heat also inside. So this is what we call the skylight to floor ratio. What is the percentage of roof area which is open for daylight to the floor area? That is what the skylight to floor air ratio. So what we simply put it as an SFR, skylight to floor rate, floor ratio. Normally the custom, the thumb rule people follow is a 5%, which means 5% of the roof area is opened up for skylights to get all the daylight inside. But in a countries like India, when you open 5% of the roof area, the solar radiation has a lot of light as well as the infrared component as well. It is this infrared component which is going to heat up the entire space. So increasing this skylight to floor ratio to 5% is not good in a country like ours. So this is where these technologies can help in. Here we use around 1% of the roof area, not 5%. We just use only 1% of the roof area to get all the required daylight into the building. Which means when I am using just only 1% of the roof area, my heat input into the building, basically the solar radiation input in the building itself, is very, very low. That's where you do a lot of heat management, wherein you get the light, but you don't get the heat into the building. So buildings like this, which are air conditioned, can be perfectly lit up with daylight without adding any heat onto the air conditioning. Now, effectively, if you see in any good daylighting design, we help in the reduction of the cooling load of the building, because the daylight illumination is quite high. It reduces the heat input into the building. It cuts off the the heat that comes from electric lighting. So overall, it reduces the cooling load over air conditioning systems. So buildings like this, and these are all air conditioned buildings wherein daylight is being brought from outside. Now these are the multi-glazed skylight systems. So unlike the normal skylights using 5% of the roof area, these multi-glazed systems, they use less than 1% of the roof area to get all the light inside. So a lot of projects, when we see the economics of installing these skylights and daylighting technologies, people keep asking, what is the payback period? What is the return on investment? Because essentially this is energy saving technology wherein we are switching off the electric lighting. How much energy are we saving? These are the questions that come up. So here we are taking a typical case study. We are taking a building of, say, a 2000 square meter floor plate area with an average height of 12 meters. And it has a daylighting system, the prismatic skylights. If you see, we have used the SFR around 1.5% here, using a design illuminance of around 275 to 300 lux. So we can actually do the software modeling of that to simulate what is the daylighting output typically to a given location. For any given location anywhere, we can take the weather file of that particular location and do run a simulation to understand it. Then if you do an electric lighting simulation for a given area, for a given lux, you know probably how much of the lighting load is required. So if you use an energy efficient LED lighting system, typically we end up using around 8.4 kilowatt of electric lighting load required for a 2000 square meter building. So here this runs the energy savings. So when we compare it to an LED lighting, the connected load of 8.4 kilowatt with the average daylighting hours of around 10 hours in a day, considering the electricity unit cost, we will have around 2.7 lakhs as a energy savings. So when you do a daylighting design, use a proper skylights, a good quality multi-glazed skylights for these type of building. Essentially, the payback period for this building on a 2000 square meter floor plate, it should not be more than 2 years. Which means they are very, very cost effective in terms of their energy saving potential. And the life of these systems typically would be around 15 years. Which means, after 2 years, you are just running on the energy savings are just accruing to us without any recurring cost to us. Now, here is a case study where we have done for the rail coach factory of Indian Railways at the Raibareli. It's a more than 1 lakh square meter building, as I said, of around 15 meter height with a completely insulated roof. This was done in the year 2015. So here the payback period, as they calculate the Indian Railways, this is over 28 months. More than 1 lakh square meter building was completely lit up with the daylighting. So this was, till to date, the largest daylighting project ever executed in India or in Asia. And Indian Railways, after this initiative, a lot of buildings, right from their sports stadiums to their wagon workshops to coach factories, a lot of their buildings, and even in the administrative buildings, they are converting them into using daylight. So So these are some of the payback calculations. I will go into the these are some of the slides of different snapshots of the different workshops of that rail coach factory. Now what I'm presenting is a new case study where the Chennai International Terminal building, the new building which is being built for the Chennai airport. So this will be the first airport in India going with exclusive daylight harvesting. So normally in airports till today, what we have seen is again a lot of glass around, and daylight, whatever it is coming through that, is the penetration what we are looking at. But in this particular building, as you see the photograph, there are a lot of daylighting systems being installed from the roof. Here the false ceiling is around 4.5 meters below the floor, below the roof level. The building is around 58,000 square meters with a typical false ceiling height of 26 meters from the floor level. So here in this system, these systems are equipped with active tracking. For the first time in India, the sunlight tracking system is being deployed, where the systems will be actively tracking the sun movement in across the sky, capturing all the light, so maximizes the collection of light and puts it through the system, and through the light diffusers, light spreads into the airport. And these systems also will be equipped with the daylight sensors and the lighting controllers. So the system will be completely integrated to the airport electric lighting. So seamlessly, the daylight will be functioning along with the electric lighting of the airport, which means if the daylight level is less, then the electric lighting is automatically switched on, vice versa it happens. These are some of the So here what we have just concluded is the top lighting strategy, that is wherein we use the skylights as well as the light pipes.
Yes, thank you so much, Mr. Nori. I think this was very clear and simple, the way you've explained so far. So I think it's a nice point to just have a little fun poll so that we see, you know, if everybody has understood what you've explained and they are actually paying attention. So we'll do a very quick poll, which is a quiz. So the first question, which will now you can see on your screen. Everybody watching and listening into the webinar, you'll be able to click the answer on your screen. The question is, good daylight has high uniformity ratio. Yes, no, not sure. So select one answer and click on your screen so we get the vote. And we'll wait for a couple more seconds to get the votes in. And then if there is, depending on the answers, we can discuss this question. Or a little bit more votes coming in. Wow. All right, so 75 people are saying yes, and 20% is saying no, and the rest is not sure. It's pretty interesting. Initially, when the votes were coming in, it was like 95% of the people were saying yes. So this point was discussed in the beginning. Good daylight has high uniformity ratio, which is true. Because if you don't have a good uniformity ratio, it means that there are some dark spots and some light spots, so the contrast is very high. When the contrast is very high, it's a little uncomfortable, and if depending on the level of contrast, it could even result in glare. So ideally, to have a high amount of uniformity ratio in a space is desirable, and that is a good daylighting strategy, right? So
points on this, Deepa.
Yeah, sure.
Normally in a lighting design, electrical lighting or daylighting, in the pursuit of reducing the connected load, that is the watts per a square foot or a square meter area of a building. So people are reducing the wattage. So what we see a lot of times in lighting design is people compromise on this uniformity ratio principle. So in electric lighting, what we see, you know, a lot of buildings, when they do the design, we look at it, people hardly achieve 0.4 or 0.5 uniformity. An ideal good lighting design calls for achieving at least 0.7.
Okay.
So just reduction of wattage or reducing the amount of light in building is not going to help. How you diffuse the light, achieve a lot of uniformity across the entire floor plate is more critical in a proper lighting design. Daylight by inherent characteristics, because of its full spectrum light, and if you have a light good diffusions into the system, it gives an excellent diffusion, and uniformity will be very, very high.
Right, yes, absolutely. So watts per square feet is not really the indicator of the quality of lighting design. But like you said, uniformity ratio is the real indicator.
Right.
And of course, the efficacy. Yes, next question is, light pipes can transport daylight horizontally. Yes, no, not sure. This point was also discussed in the presentation. So please click and submit your answer so we get the votes. Waiting for a couple more seconds. Okay, I don't think there is much confusion in this question. Oops, it's changing. Okay, so wow, here also we have a 75% saying yes and 25% saying no. I think, Mr. Nori, you can explain this.
These pipes, the light pipes can actually transport light horizontally, vertically. They can transport light in whatever fashion it is. Absolutely, there is no limitation on the transportation of light, either an inclined, horizontal, or vertical. It doesn't matter.
Right. So you can transport daylight horizontally, and you can have, like you said, on the wall as well, right?
Like an AC duct, you can run these pipes, just like an AC duct, you can run the pipes to get light inside.
Is there any like efficiency wise, the vertical versus horizontal, in terms of the lux levels that you get as output, or even the lumens actually?
No, there is no difference. In the light transmission, the loss of light transmission when you do it vertical or horizontal.
Great. That's really good to know, because sometimes you would need it on a in the horizontal way as well, right? You may not have the floor, I mean roof space available. All right, next question here coming up on the screen is, the question is, multi-glazed skylight systems, basically what we've discussed in the presentation so far, that kind of technology provides high efficacy daylight compared to a conventional skylight. Yes, no, not sure. Conventional, by conventional skylight, we mean, you know, you get your polycarbonate skylights. That's what we mean by conventional.
Right.
So the key word is high efficacy. So if you understand what high efficacy is, please put your votes in. Either way, just give your vote. Even if you're not sure, just make sure you click so that, you know, we have the discussion. Because if everyone's going to say yes, then there will be no discussion. All right, so the votes have come in. 90% is saying yes, and 2% is no, and the rest is not sure. So it's a predominant yes. I think that's the whole crux of this presentation, that you know, compared to a conventional skylights, these systems really increase the diffusion, and so you get way more lumen output. So there is one before and after picture as well shown. It clearly kind of shows the lumen output, which is very much more enhanced for the skylight systems. But you don't call them skylight only, right?
Yeah, we are going to call them skylight only.
Right. You should think of a special name for it. Okay, so let's resume now.
So here we are talking about the side lighting. Side lighting means we are trying to gather as much daylight as possible from the glass. Either it could be the windows, or it could be the complete the structural glazing of the building. Today we see a huge amount of glass being used in the buildings. Now, unlike earlier walls, today glass is replacing them. Unlike the walls, the essential difference with the glass would be transmitting energy. Huge amount of energy it transmits. We need to know how to handle this amount of energy that is being transmitted from the glass. Earlier, that was not the issue, but today with the glass, a transmittive medium, we need to understand how we handle them. So again, the two energy forms, light and heat, that comes to the glass are very, very important. Initially, we'll talk more about how we handle the light. So the couple of other slides, we'll talk about how we manage the heat part of it. Now, wherever glass is being used, there are three critical factors in daylighting design. One is we need to get light. We should not get heat. And our visibility through the glass should always be intact. So when we say the visibility, you should not be drawing blinds on the glass. So today we see a lot of glass buildings. Glass is used, and we put up all the blinds in the glass, and we switch on the electric lighting. Today, you see more or less all the buildings are like that. Now, how we handle this light from the glass is important. So glass normally it transmits a direct sunlight. It causes hot spots or bright spots near to that. So it causes a lot of glare. Because of these hot spots on the glass and a lot of glare that comes through, people they draw the blind on the glass to make it more comfortable. So the moment we draw a blind on the glass, which blocks the natural light, your electric lighting is switched on, which means you are adding a lot of heating load. Actually, from electric lighting, you get a lot of heat also. You are adding a lot of heat onto the building. So at one time, you are not using the light, which is going to come through the glass. And others, on the other side, you are adding the heat from the electric lighting, and you are consuming the electricity on this. Now, if we can look at a solution of the light shelf, a well-designed light shelf, which can redirect the sunlight onto the ceiling, and this redirected light from the ceiling, if it can spread into the building space very effectively, that would be an ideal daylighting system. So which means, you know, around 1 foot below the ceiling level, we need to have this light shelf. This light shelf should be typically around 1.5 foot to 2 feet height below the ceiling. This captures the sunlight which is incident on that and redirects the light to the ceiling. So this redirected light comes in a diffused and indirect manner. It does not hit our eye. It does not directly incidence on your table. And the penetration level of this redirected light would be typically around 10 to 15 meters from the perimeter of the building. Suppose from the window, you can get a penetration of around 10 to 15 meters. So this is a graph which typically shows from a normal window to a light shelf equipped window. So the light diffusion, as you see, distance, the x-axis shows the distance away from the perimeter of the building, that is the window. So around up to, you see, you are able to capture nearly 100 lux of light, 100 lux of daylight, effectively up to, say, 15 meters from the window. So what you see is, in a building which is having a north-south orientation, you can have a floor plate of nearly 25 meters, a 25 meter floor plate without any electric lighting, with a north-south orientation. This is achievable perfectly with a good light shelf. So here you are using just 1.5 to 2 feet of your glass to get all the light inside. So this is a typical graph which shows, you know, how much of light penetration that can happen. So this is what we are saying, the light shelf which is on the top side, around 2 feet on the top side below the ceiling, that redirects all the light into the building. Now, 2 feet below the false ceiling, we are trying to redirect the light and take it inside. Now, below the 2 feet level, to the floor level, what we normally call as the vision panel. That is the panel of the glass through which, or the window through which we see, we connect it to the outside. That's what we call the vision panel. So through this vision panel, you should see that light is now in this picture. What you see, a clear glass giving you a direct sunlight, and the other part of window equipped with a system which blocks the majority of the radiation. It just gives a diffused light blocking the heat. So 70 to 80% of the radiation is blocked, and balance 20-30% is deflected and diffused into the building. When you have a clear sky conditions outside, typically around 70,000 lux to 1 lakh lux, the 20-30% is very good enough for us for a building illumination requirement. So on the systems, in the windows or the glass, whenever you have a system like this, you do not have to put up any blinds on the glass. We can use a simple clear glass, no need for a tinted glass or any coated glass. A simple clear glass is all we require, and without any blind, irrespective of the orientation of the glass, south or even west, we can absolutely manage the daylight diffusion without heat coming into the building. Wow, sorry, I think the slides are... So this slide show, this slide shows, you know, the radiance energy of the sun being reflected, the majority of it is reflected out. Now the south and west side of the building. And this graph typically shows with the sun elevation angle, how is the light transmission through the glass is changing. So when the sun is at a low elevation angles, typically below 25 degrees, we allow the lot of light to come inside. So we allow the solar radiation to come inside, because anything below 25 degree, it is not associated with much of a heat of the sun. So when the sun starts going up in the sky, the heat content is more. So when the elevation angle is more than 20, 25 degrees, you see the cutoff function of the glazing starts coming in. So nearly 70 to 80% of the radiation is blocked, and just 20-30% is allowed to go inside in a diffused way. Now today, these systems have developed so much so that we can do a characterization wherein you can do a simulation also on the building using these panels. You can do a prediction like, you know, what we do for the simulation for a glass and other things. You can do a lighting a simulation with these. CEPT and Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, US, together they have done a simulation of these characterization of these systems to do the prediction of that. Actually, if you do an IR imaging on these systems, you see a temperature difference between a double glazed glass to these systems nearly to a tune of around 7 to 8 degrees. And if you take a solar energy transmission meter and if you measure the amount of energy being transmitted from these things, there will be a difference of around 75% energy per square meter of the glazing that is being blocked by these systems. So these 75% reduction of solar radiant heat means our cooling load of the building reduces dramatically. It is not just the lighting, but it is essentially the cooling load of the building. Your air conditioner, where you are using a 2-ton air conditioner, you can use just a 1-ton air conditioner to maintain a very optimum level of cooling in the building. So we do not have to do the outdoor systems like this to cut down the elevation and the azimuth angle of the suns. The simple systems, which are more cost effective, can be built onto the glass. And that too, as I said, a simple clear glass, not even a tinted glass. We don't require any films on the glass. You get a good view through the glass. So your connection to the exterior is always there. Now, having talked about the daylighting, what is very important is we need to control the electric lighting in synchronous with the daylight, which is available in the building. Otherwise, we don't achieve any energy efficiency. Without a proper lighting controls, daylighting per se is not going to do any energy efficiency. Because people do not have the habit, most of it, to switch off the electric lighting. They switch on the electric lighting, but they don't switch off the electric lighting. So we need an integration. And that too, we always require in a working space a constant lux level. Whereas the daylight sometimes, you know, it changes through the course of the day. So we need to integrate both of them to see the building occupants, they do not have too much of variations of light through the day, and energy efficiency is there. So there are various strategies again followed. Typically what we call the open loop method and the closed loop method, how we sense the daylight. So in an open loop system, there is always a daylight sensor which captures the sunlight, the ambient light available, and it gives feed to the lighting controller. The lighting controller then controls the electric lighting of the building. So here the daylight sensor measures the ambient light through the controller and the control panel. It does it. And today I think the systems are advanced, wherein we have built-in energy monitoring system also, which can actually empirically measure the amount of electrical energy consumed by the building electric lighting when there is a daylighting systems are there. So they show actually the amount of energy savings you are going to obtain. A lot of buildings, what we have seen and we have done daylighting design, we see that 70 to 80% savings on electric lighting load. So this is again a strategy wherein the closed loop sensor. Essentially, the difference between a closed loop sensor and an open loop sensor is, in a closed loop sensor, you actually measure the light on the task plane, wherever you want the light. At that point, the light is measured. In an open loop system, you measure the ambient light. In a closed loop sensor, you measure the task light. And you control the electric lighting based on that. So both these systems have an advantage and disadvantage. And depending on the type of the building, the type, whether a closed loop method or an open loop method to be followed should be taken in. So this is what today what we call the hybrid daylighting. So it is about electric lighting and daylighting working in tandem and working with along with each other, supplementing each other. And today the systems have gone to the point that we have the occupancy sensors also built along with the daylighting system. So which means you have a lighting control system, you have an occupancy sensor, you have a daylighting. So all the three of them, they kick in whenever it is required. So when you have an electric lighting, daylight is there, electric lighting systems are switched off. But during the evening hours, that is night time, so the daylight is not there, electric lighting is switched on, but people are not there. So then this is the occupancy sensor. It switches off the electric lighting. So which means, you know, today the hybridization of all these sensors and lighting are brought onto a common platform to improve the energy efficiency of the buildings. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Nori, for again the second part, which was again clear and concise. And we have some questions coming in. So we'll start taking the questions. And again, if you know anyone else, if you have some questions, then please start putting it in your chat box so we receive them and we start taking them one by one. The first question is, are light pipes controllable? I think what they mean is that the daylight in the light pipe, can that be controlled?
Yes, light pipe, the daylight which is streaming through the light pipe can be controlled. So we have a system today wherein you want to switch it off just like electric lighting. You can control the daylight which is coming through that. Yes, it is controllable.
That's fantastic. Actually, I'd like to know how is that done?
Basically, it has a dimmer system inside. So whenever you don't want the light to come through, you just switch it on. So there is a very small miniatured motor which controls the diaphragm of that, and it closes the in the light pipe. So the light is actually, light transmission is completely blocked. So that is how it is. Suppose you are doing in a conference room, you wanted a complete a bit dark, or suppose you are doing any residence with a bedroom, you don't want the light to come in. So right. You can switch off the daylight as well.
That's actually great to know. I had no idea about that. Next question is daylighting still worth it when you consider installation costs in a big multi-story building?
Please come again.
Yeah. Is daylighting still worth to be considered when you, I mean, when you consider the installation cost in a big multi-story building? I think the question is about, is the cost justified even if it's a very large project?
The very large project, this is very, very valid, because the overall cost in terms of the electric lighting energy, and as I said, the cooling load of the building, the air conditioning load, if you consider both of them, the daylighting systems, whatever effective daylighting systems on the fenestration, they pay you back in 1 year. It's very, very cost effective, and it needs to be seriously pursued in a large projects. In a very small project, the significance is not much, but larger buildings, it makes a lot of impact.
Right. In fact, all your examples were also quite large scale. So I'm sure cost-wise, it would have been, I mean, you already showed the calculations of the payback and everything. It made it right. Very much. Okay, the next question is, I think it's already been discussed, maybe you can just reiterate it. What's like the maximum lux levels you could achieve in a light pipe system?
So the lux levels what we can achieve is typically up to 1000 lux we can get.
Right.
We can achieve as much as 1000 lux. Suppose we do some of the garment factories. In the garment factories or inspection areas, the amount of lighting that is required is very high. The requirement standards are very high. Because it's a very fine work, you require typically more than 700, 800 lux. So we deliver that amount of lighting in these places. So we can actually know, that is what we call the daylighting design. Just like you do the electric lighting, here also, say, suppose for a warehouse, you don't require more than 100 lux. And in some places, you require around 1000 lux, 800 lux. In some places, typically for reading application, you require 200, 300 lux. Like that, depending on the application and the function of the space, we design the type of a daylighting system that is required and optimized for that application.
Right. Okay, next question. Are the light shelf panels removable? I think this is in reference to that, the sky shelf.
Yeah, these light shelf panels are, you can easily remove them. Okay. You can detach them from the glass, not a problem.
Right. Next question is the sky shelf an integral part of the window system, or is that something that is just attached? So can it work for a retrofit?
It can perfectly work for a retrofit. So it is attached. It is not an integral part of that.
Okay. Next question. What is the maximum advisable length for daylight pipes?
Around 12 meters, 40 feet.
Right. Okay. Next question is, can skyshades be installed in the existing glazed systems? I think this is in reference to skylight. So,
yeah.
Please go ahead.
So retrofitting is absolutely possible. In a lot of projects in the existing buildings, this retrofitting happens. Why it happens in a large scale in retrofitting, I will tell you, is because now people feel the discomfort of not having a daylight, or rather they feel the discomfort of a lot of heat coming through the glass. It is only when they react. That's how the retrofitting happens in lot of buildings. During the construction time, people do not really visualize it. But once they start occupying the building, they will start feeling this. Then over a period of time, they do the retrofitting to the building. So retrofitting is perfectly fine. It can be done.
Right. Okay, and the last question is, can the light bulbs be integrated with BMS?
No, you cannot, we cannot integrate them to BMS. Basically here, the lights, light pipe, it transfers the daylight, but the daylight sensors and the controllers, they can be integrated to the building management system, BMS.
Right. Great. So that is it. With that, we come to the end of the webinar. Thank you so much, Mr. Nori, for taking out time and for sharing your expertise and knowledge and taking all the questions. I thank you so much about it. And just a few things before we end the session today. Again, if you haven't really visited our website, in the Knowledge Center, you can find many resources about daylighting, general design strategies, design approaches, and some case studies as well. And next week, we are going to talk about high-performance glazing technology. So it's all going to be about glass and what is cutting edge about glass as a technology and how it really relates to high-performance buildings. That's next week at 4 p.m. If you weren't aware, we are doing these organizing NZ tours, which is basically taking you to net zero energy as well as high performance building tours across several cities. We have one planned on 9th August for to Plant 13 Annex. This is an operational net zero building in Mumbai. This is already closed right now for registration. And after that, on 24th August, we have the Carbs building, which is another net zero building at SEPT campus in Ahmedabad. Again, just make sure that you know about it and in time you're able to register for the tour. And we're announcing the Net Zero Energy International Conference. This is just for you to save the date, which is on 15th and 16th October in Delhi. In the subsequent weeks, we will share further details about it, but for now, just save the date. Again, to get all of these news, you can subscribe to our monthly newsletter called the NZEP Times. Everything to do with webinars, events, conference, tours, contests, and any other initiative we are doing for promoting net zero buildings in India, you can get the first-hand information from this newsletter. And lastly, I just want to share about this competition called Inspire. In fact, it's a symposium called Inspire 2019, organized by EESL, Energy Efficiency Services Limited. It is also a partner, Maitri program partner, and you can know more about it on their website. Actually, Inspire is something that EESL has launched to this specifically. This is the challenge that they have launched. First of its kind energy innovation challenge. And here participants are invited to submit sustainable and scalable solutions on five themes, which is improved grid management system, energy efficient technology, clean energy, electric mobility, and financial improvements. So you can submit your idea and participate in this competition. And with that, the last thing is to connect with us on social media so you have first-hand information of all the events and activities that we are doing. And with that, I will see you next week. Thank you so much for signing in.
Thank you.
Thank you.